Henry Rawlinson woke hot and fidgety, fuss, fuss, bother and itch. His conscious mind coming up too fast with the bends through pack ice, throbbing seas, boom sounders, blowholes, harsh croaks and blind men tip-tap talking for escape from his pressing skull.
Welk.
With a gaseous grunt, he rolled away from the needle-cruel light acupuncturing those fogged pickle-onion eyes and focused them with key-bending will on the cold trench Flory had left on her side of the bed. Tongue like yesterday's fried cod. Mind over batter. Blech. Tongue sandwiches? Eat what? But it's been in somebody else's mouth. You'll eat it and like it. But why can't I have? Because I say so. The blind men were now thrashing with their canes. God's teeth, do I need a dare of the hog? Nothing like a morning cap to kiss goodbye to the day. He reached across for the bell rope to summon the housekeeper. But with most of his huge top stiff from the wallop he'd received on the back of the neck from the half-thawed chicken, he discovered himself with his nightie round his waist, stunned, turned tortoise on the rug. The paralysis lasted scarce a blink. Then he bellied his unwilling hulk to the wardrobe. Cold comfort as he yanked out the shotgun. Good stock. Roll over, one action, commando stuff. Cock over, safety off, left and right, both barrels through the ceiling. Stun, shock, unsilence, and then Henry's eruptive bellow. Mrs. E! The plaster had not settled before the housekeeper stood lurcher-backed and coughing at your servile, sir, in the room.
Yes,
she said.
I don't know what I want, but I want it now.
I don't know, I got out of bed this morning, I had it all down one side, and when I put my foot down, it was like plugging into the mains.
Mrs. E had trouble.
It shot straight up and I came over all giddy and I thought, oh no, I'm going. I thought, no, come, come, come. I'll breathe me last. And it started swimming before me. I could smell the wreath. Oh, such a good cry. It was lovely. I just wanted to lay back, but I couldn't. Of course, I can't recline now. He's put me on tablets, but it's a constant fight to relax. To try. Last Sunday, I was heating up a drop of liniment and I bent down to pull up my surgical stockings. When, oh, it slipped out again and I was that busy. I didn't have time to straighten out because I can't sleep. Not since Mr. E passed away. It's like having your leg off. I mean, you think it's still there in the bed. I mean, you think it's still... It's 33 years on Thursday and I still can't get used to his snoring. It's in the mornings that he used to make me a herbal infusion.
Mrs. E, dismiss. I will come down. Help me up.
The table was still laid for breakfast, and when the Rawlinson family broke a fast, you cursed central heating and double glazing.
Awkward beasts, Winkles,
grunted Henry, squinting and stabbing at his plate.
Your Uncle Hubert uses them for earplugs.
Rafe had heard it all before. He smiled bleakly across at his father.
Turns my belly to see him in the mornings fiddling about in his lug holes with a pin. Blessed if I can see why he bothers. He never hears anything I say.
To some extent, this was true. Henry's rhinoceros tyranny had only the most peripheral and incidental effect on Hubert's life, and he spent his days softly and dreamily, without any direction, quoting and reliving his times with his dead father. He was harmless, but, as Flory put it, unusual.
I remember shrimp teas on a gingham cloth, shiny brown bowls and crusty bread, and a little boy who wouldn't eat mummy shrimps with all their precious grey-pink eggs.
Stuff it, Hubert!
Henry went up to change. Flory, wanting to make an impression, spent a long time checking the bathroom and family for tide marks, and when she'd done it was evening. There was a screech of tortured wheels, a bump, a loud splash and a bubbling sound. That sounds like Doris and Harold now, said Flory.
Get 'em out of the ornamental pond. Scrotum! Gaffer neck! Hang 'em over the radiators and I'll set up the card table myself.
All was now expectancy as the soaked Harold Hazard entered the house. Oh, gad! He yelped as he bumped his head on the door. Yikes! Said Doris, tripping over the attractive boot cleaner and getting a warm coconut matting welcome stamped indelibly on her face. They joined Henry, who was in the library drinking and being important.
Personally, when you're dead, you're gone. After life, after shave, don't hold with any of them.
He glared at great-aunt Flory, who was of quite a different opinion, and almost chandelier with piskies, St. Christopher, crucifix, rabbit's foot, and lucky whale's teeth about her neck.
I don't give a toss what you do with me when I've shrugged off me mortal coil. Shove a bit of flex up my back passage, stick a light bulb in my mouth, and stand me in the hall. Mind you, if you're using electricity, you'll have to dry me out first.
Florrie had once mentioned instant karma to Henry, but he thought it was some kind of tranquilizer. There was really little point now. He was too far gone.
Consulting a book called Itching before she goes to the lavatory. Good God, what did I marry?
It was a lovely evening, and Florrie took the interminable beige thing she was knitting into the garden. About her were perhaps 200 gnomes.
Sitting in the sunken garden, pinking in the sinking sun, thinking of a summer long ago when one was 21. Naming all the flowers so friendly, shouting at the shrubs so thick. Lo, behold, lobelia, one bite and the bishop was sick. How nice to be in England, now that England's here. I stand upright in my wheelbarrow and pretend I'm Boadicea.
There was a face-jumping competition at the Fool and Bladder. This ancient amusement involved leaping onto volunteers' heads, lightly touching and then springing off. To draw blood or squash a nose meant instant disqualification, and this was the skill of it. The normally phlegmatic Seth One-Tooth was unquestioned champion of this unusual sport, and he stood, huge, dark and work-stained, outside the old pub, explaining the rules and recalling past triumphs to Red Schmeaton, the village newsagent and self-styled human encyclopedia. A large red-faced farm worker, stripped to the waist, paced out an enormous run-up before turning to thunder down on his grinning partner lying on the grass.
He's got no chance, said Seth smugly. Silly buggers wearing spiked running shoes.
Reg Smeaton, Flocko's red wig like a kipper nailed to his bonce, nodded with ill-feigned interest. But the mad flexions of his face muscles and the nervous butterfly tick of his left eyelid argued the mental tumult within. Jigging, niggling sail of the centipedes and the quacking going up to £5, urging datum and fervid facts, chattering in Stockhausen tongues, warring for outlet from his springboard lips.
Drawing from my vast, though admittedly unresolved, catalogue of general know-it-all, facts of interest, etc., corroborated, corroboree, a sacred or warlike assembly of aboriginals, and cross-reference, may I remind you of the exploits of one William Barker of Manchester? In the 1890s, Billy cleared a canal 35 feet wide, making a running jump, jackknifing into a second, to land perfectly quite dry on the other side. This was called spring jumping, nothing at all to do with the period vernal equinox to summer solstice, of course.
Heedless of this babble, Seth adjusted the strings about his knees, and unnoticed, a passing wood-pigeon vacated onto Smeaton's ploughman's lunch.
"I ain't so nimble now," said Seth, "but I used to jump in and out at barrels of eggs without cracking a shell."
Smeaton, his mouth full of cheese, squinted fixedly at the sun.
Barrels, Coopering, James Fenimore, 1789-1851. Mohicans, the last of. Natty Bumpo, Prince Bumpo, Bumptious Bumpkins. Kith and Kin, Jakin John Peel, Peeler. Sir Robert, Bobby's Babies, Bibulous Bibles. I could clear a snooker table, full length, mind, from a standing jump before operation, grumbled Seth. I could have made a mint had I been a bit more shrewd.
Shrewd? Did you know that the elephant shrew never closes its eyes?
Remarked Smeaton. At this juncture, they were joined by old Scrotum, who had slogged it across the fields in time for the finals and to down a couple of pints or three.
What's a good drinking time?
Reg Smeaton, smelling strongly of newsprint, patted down the back of his wig.
Did you know there is no proper name for the back of the knees?
What was left standing of the village band slurred into voice, and old Scrotum, now flushed and enlivened with his seventh mug of scrumpy, needed small press to clamber onto a bench for a lively but crack-throated rendering.
Them farmers' boys are working hard, sir. Old soul scorch
thing is made. Draw up your will, tomorrow comes too quickly. Whistling Mademoiselle from Marmiteers. A wise man knows his onions are strong and pickly. Swill 'em down with dear old Rose's beer. Village populace is jumping on faces, catching the javelin, heading the shot.
By 9:30 that evening, back at the great house, dinner was finished, and the Rawlinsons and their guests lolled over the blancmange or sprawled back, blown out, picking their teeth.
That was inedible muck, and there wasn't enough of it. Blah.
The curry lay heavy on Sir Henry's stomach like a royal corgi.
I say, how dare you belch in front of my wife? Squeaked Lord Portly.
Henry yawned.
Sorry, old man, I didn't realise it was her turn.
This ungracious rejoinder left Lord Portly stupefied as Dr. Watson, and to cover his befuddlement, he helped himself to a liberal glass of entre-deux legs.
If I had all the money I'd spent on drink, observed Henry, I'd spend it on drink.
At that moment, Hubert, shamefaced, ventured into the room. Henry glowered at his brother, but poor Hubert, with all the assurance of a sleepwalker, announced that to make up for his past behaviour, he would like to entertain everybody with a bird impression. He began hopping about on one leg. Chirrup, chirrup. Chirrup, he mimicked, winking at the ladies. He then produced a handful of worms from his trouser pocket, and with apparent relish stuffed them into his mouth. Pop-eyed, chewing furiously and flapping his arms with the pinky tentacles writhing horribly about his chin, he advanced, chirrup, chirrup, to the table. Lady Philippa opened her handbag and with heaving shoulders buried her head in it. Next time, Mrs. E, the housekeeper, has one of her nasty turns and believes herself to be a chicken. But Henry refuses to have her treated, saying,
Well, it's always good to have a supply of fresh eggs.